Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Iyinate, and as you can see on the screen, my contacts have been provided, so you can contact me at any time. So I'm supposed to take you for the course, this course, WLSM 609, Finance for Supply Chain Managers, or simply Supply Chain Finance. All right, so supply chain management or supply chain, the supply chain actually is the physical component, and then we have the management aspect, and then we have the financial aspect. So we can group them into three broad classes. That is why we are doing the financial aspect, which is supply chain finance. But when you look at the supply chain in general, then it's something that encapsulates the activities of every organization. This is because no organization can exist in isolation. Every organization depends on one organization or two organizations or as many as the organization may have relationship with those organizations in one way or the other. Because once an organization has an objective to achieve, then that organization will at all costs consume resources. And some of these resources can be obtained from other organizations, what you describe as your suppliers, right? So there is the physical supply chain, which actually looks at the movement of activities right from the procurement stage through the conversion stage and finally to the customer. And then we have the managing aspect or the managerial aspect, which also deals with the coordination and management of other activities so that the objectives of the organization can be achieved. And then we have the financing aspect, which in actual fact, it intends to reduce costs and supply and create value for shareholders. Okay, so let's look at our course outline, right, and see what we have for the semester. Now, every organization is expected to create value and increase shareholders' wealth. Is it so? Shareholders have invested in the organization by contributing resources that will enable the organization to operate. And normally, from agency theory, management is actually separated from owners. You see, so shareholders have appointed agents, which they are the managers, to manage the affairs of the organization, and then report to these shareholders at regular intervals of time. So right now, let's look at a manufacturing concern, which procures raw materials, and that must be converted, and then the final product sent to customers in return of revenue. And that is exactly what the supply chain is all about. So when you look at the supply chain, it starts from the procurement of raw materials. If, for example, the raw material must be procured from farmers, and that is our nature here, in our environment here, we are more of agrarian. So most of the raw materials are produced or are procured from our farmers. And that must be converted. For example, look at the production of chocolate. Chocolate uses cocoa, right? So the cocoa is procured from the farmers, goes to the factory. And even look at the processes that involve in getting the dry cocoa. It involves a lot of processes, you see? So it goes through the factory in Tema, and then also must go through some processes before the final chocolate is produced for customers to consume. When you look at Volta Aluminium Company in Tema, it also produces aluminium ingots. You see, so these aluminium ingots are produced from bauxite, which is also mined by different companies. So they buy these raw materials in the form of bauxite, and then convert it into the aluminium ingot. But you can see that aluminium ingot becomes raw material for another company, especially those that produce these cooking utensils, aluminium products, and roofing sheets. You see, so they will also convert it into final products as roofing sheets or as cooking utensils for the consumer's consumption. So the supply chain is one of the key areas that ensures that the value of the shareholder is what? Increased, or shareholders' wealth is increased. So senior executives of leading companies, they understand the value of the supply chain. Of course, leading companies are large organizations, and supply chain has gained, well, it has gained much root in large organizations compared to smaller organizations. And in large organizations, we can obtain some advantages, you see, in terms of low cost of production, and then also customer satisfaction in large organizations. So when the customer sees the product as value has been added, then that will also increase the customer's profit, because the customer see the product as one that has been value has been added. You see, so the customer will purchase the product. All right. So value addition is one of the key objectives of supply chain, as we can see in the in our course objective. Now, for products-related firms, because supply chain does not only apply to firms that produce discrete parts manufacturing goods, but firms that deals in services, for example, hospitals. There is what we call the hospital supply chain. There is what we call the pharmaceutical supply chain. Of course, pharmaceuticals produce drugs, which we can see. They are tangible items that can be touched and hold. But if you go to the bank, for example, there's a supply chain. When you hand your check to the cashier, that check is converted into cash. And at the end of the day, you get your cash. So that process is also a supply chain. In actual fact, it's a production process. See, so, but when we talk of discrete parts manufacturing firm, just as we have the products related firms, the supply chain includes most of the assets of the firm. You understand? Most of the assets, because we have stock. And that is what the company is actually selling to generate revenue. So the stock has been procured from your suppliers, and it is the cost that the company is incurring. When you set aside your physical or non-current assets, such as your physical infrastructure, right? Let's say your factory, your machines, your equipment made up of motor vehicles, your computers, and so on. Those are different. But a company actually procures stock on regular basis from suppliers. And this stock can be raw materials which are to be converted into finished products. You see? So that is a cost. And if these monies are not received early for these raw materials, then the company will be in a fix of getting money to finance its activities. So in that case, the company has no option than to rely on short-term loans. And you see, short-term loans, it can be obtained at high interest rates, for which the buyer or the customer is not able to afford, you see. And that is the essence of the supply chain finance. So the supply chain finance is actually a collaborative approach that optimizes the flow of finance among supply chain partners. So we'll come to look at that as we progress very soon. So 60 to 70% of the cost, and is the foundation for generating revenue and profit. So you see, so those stock that a company has procured must be sold. You see, but what happens is that you cannot always sell on cash basis. If it's the policy of the firm that cash must be paid instantly for the goods that are being demanded. Then the goods will remain in stock because you have competitors who are ready to offer the goods on credit. So what normally happens, especially this happens among larger organizations, the sale is on credit. Just as when you are also procuring your raw materials, you do that based on credit. So there are two main accounts that are normally created between buyers and suppliers. So if you're a credit buyer, then you have accounts receivable, right? If you are buying from somebody, then you become an accounts payable. Okay, then we have accounts. So we have two main accounts, accounts receivable and accounts payable. Okay, now, however, supply chains make revenues possible. Because from historical point of view, they have considered firms as what? So, they have viewed supply chain as primarily a call center, you see? Because the main aim of supply chain in the past has been to that of cost reduction and also creation of value. So it has been considered as a call center, just a cost reduction. And the cost reduction normally is associated with the procurement of the raw material stage to the final consumer stage. So what you are looking at is quite different a bit, right? So however, supply chains make revenues possible and properly develop. Now, revenues will be made possible if only there has been value addition to the raw material. You understand? So if the carpenter is able to convert the raw wood into a very nice furniture, you see, that means that value has been added. And this normally comprises a lot of components or a lot of supplies, you see, such as what? Polish. Or spraying, you see, that has been used to make, to finish the furniture. So you see it as what? Value has been added. And normally from the customer's point of view, there is value addition if the customer sees the product as at a higher, that is, values have been added to the product than what the customer perceives originally. All right. So we're saying that, however, supply chains make revenues possible and properly develop, that is, if they are properly developed and managed, can improve profitability and more effectively deploy capital, you see. So hence, organizations of the future must focus on more on this supply. Just, I think there's a miss. Okay, focus on more than just driving costs and improving product availability. Something is missing there, but we can solve it. Okay, so as supply chain optimal organizations evolve from back office, tactical operations, strategic functions. Now, all that this is saying is that supply chain is also a strategic function. You know, we have three levels of management. Strategic, we have the tactical, which is the middle level management, and then we have the operational. So supply chain normally also evolve, you see, from the tactical operations and then through the strategic management functions. It is becoming more important for supply chain professionals to speak the language of the CFO. Okay, so inside world-class organizations, the supply chain function is viewed by senior leadership as a critical success factor to achieving optimal financial health, reflected on the profit and loss, the balance sheet, and the funds flow statement. So we'll be looking at these three statements, financial statements of organizations. But the two key components of the balance sheet, that is the inventory, which is a stock, right? And then we'll look at accounts payable and accounts receivable. Of course, Organizations can adopt a supply chain finance by relying on these three financing activities: accounts payable, accounts receivable, and then inventory financing. So we'll look at those ones too in our course content. That is adopting supply chain finance based on these three types of components in the balance sheet. Now, this necessitates that supply chain professionals understand the financial impacts of their decisions and actions and are adept at pulling the right levers to improve a firm's financial scorecard. Okay, so that is what the course actually is all about. So when we talk of supply chain finance, it is made up of three different actors: the customer, right, or the buyer, and then the supplier, and then a financial institution, especially a bank. And then there must be a network platform, you see. So information technology also plays a significant role, because all that we are talking about, they normally happen on the internet. So you must be, you have access to internet. All the three groups that I've mentioned must have access to internet so that this can properly work. All right, now let's look at the course content. First, we'll look at supply chain from a broader perspective. So that is a broad aspect of the supply chain. And it is involved the physical supply chain. So physical supply chain, then we're talking about the facilities, such as your inventory warehousing facilities for inventory management, your processing facilities, your distribution facilities, and so on. And then we also look at supply chain management. So supply chain itself is a different concept from supply chain management concept. Are you okay? And supply chain management concept is also different from supply chain finance. Of course, supply chain finance has to do with the management of the financial aspect of the supply chain. So look at these three in a brief. And then we'll look at supply chain finance instruments. So when we talk about supply chain finance, we have some instruments or models that actually underpin supply chain finance. For example, reverse factoring. Reverse factoring must involve all the partners in the supply chain. Okay, we also have dynamic discounting, inventory financing, and then purchasing order financing. Then we'll then look at the financial statements. So look at the income statement, which is the profit and loss account. What are the components? For example, the reporting of your turnover, right? Turnover or revenue is a typical component. Your cost of goods sold is another component. Your gross profit, and then your expenses in terms of administrative, finance, and then distributive expenses, they are all components. So these are the components of the income statement or the PLL account. Then the statement of financial position, or what we call the balance sheet. Also, we have the assets, and this asset column is made up of the non-current assets. So non-current assets are the physical things that we see, such as land, your buildings, vehicles, equipment, computers, and so on. And then the liabilities column, we also have a non-current asset, such as your bank, your cash, your inventory, and so on. And then we'll look at the reason why we have them like that. And then the balance sheet, the liabilities. So those that the company owes. Okay. And then we have owner's equity column. So that is the purpose for building the pro forma. Okay. And then we look at cash flow statements. So cash flow statements, we look at from the operations activities, investing activities, and then financing activities. because this supply chain finance actually involves the flow of cash, you see. So if we don't understand cash flow statements, then we'll not be able to actually look at this supply chain finance properly. Okay, so there are also, we can also have the adoption of supply chain finance by CFOs using the accounts receivable finance approach, or the inventory finance approach, or the accounts payable finance approach. Okay, so look at that. And one of the requirements of supply chain finance is that there must be collaborative actions. That is, all the parties involved in a supply chain finance must collaborate. So there is what we call inter-organizational finance. You see, so basically they are involving these three people that I've mentioned, right? The purchaser or the customer, the supplier, and then the financial institution, which normally is a bank. So for this to be actually achieved, the CFO must collaborate. So it must possess some collaborative factors. For example, collaborative performance system. You see, so does your system actually perform based on some collaborative factors? Information sharing, and that is one of the key components of supply chain management. If the other parties, they lack information, then there will be no flow of, the supply chain actually cannot flow because you don't know what is happening among the three of you. Decision synchronization, you see, you must all arrive at an acceptable decision, and then incentive alignment, and then integrated supply chain process. Then we'll look at where we have to find we have to find the impact of the supply chain design on cost. So you design your supply chain. Some supply chains, from the nature of their designs, may have a significant impact on cost. So may generate more cost than some other designs. So we look at supply chain design for the chief finance officer in terms of analyzing financial health, such as polar recap, and then impact of supply chain design on cost. Okay, and then we measure the supply chain performance from the CFO perspective, right? And then finally, we try to improve the supply chain performance, looking at how we design our supply chain from product launch, and also making capital improvements to the supply chain. All right, so in brief, this is what we have in stock. Okay, so this lecture will be very brief, because that is the starting point. So let's look at the mode of delivery. Obviously, because we are not meeting face to face, we cannot have interaction. We cannot interact. By natural fact, of course, the mode of delivery should have comprised the lecture sessions, class discussions, and then group presentation. But because of the situation, class discussion and group presentation will actually not be possible. So I'll be delivering through the video, but if you have anything, you can just alert me. You can do that through my email, or you can text me, or you can WhatsApp me, or you can by call, depending on which one you think is appropriate for you. All right, so our main text for the course is the Supply Chain Finance, that's the 2015 edition. And the publisher is McGraw-Hill or CREATE. The ISBN number is 7978-13084463-18. All right. And this book is available as an ebook. It's an electronic book. So when you go to the link that has been provided below, you can get copies. But we are not relying on only that book. right? We can have other additional books that you can use to supplement your reading. So these four additional books are also available. You can also get them if you just type into Google Scholar, you might get them. All right. So let's look at our first lecture. And in this first lecture, we are to obtain these objectives, to achieve these objectives. We need to be able to differentiate between the supply chain in general from a broader perspective. What is the supply chain? And then also supply chain management, and then the supply chain finance. So these are different concepts that we need to understand. So that will enable us to understand the supply chain finance properly. Now, we have to explain the concept of supply chain finance. At the end of the day, you should be able to understand what we mean by supply chain finance. And also identify and explain the objectives or the aims of supply chain finance, right? And describe the factors that influence the development of supply chain finance after the global financial crisis in 2008. Now, you know that this supply chain finance concept came up as a result of the global financial crisis that we witnessed in 2008. Now, after the crisis, you see, every organization was finding it difficult to raise capital from banks or other financial institutions. So this supply chain finance actually came up as a way of getting finance or making finance flow, financial flow among partners, right? So we look at the origins. There are certain factors that actually contributed to the development of supply chain finance, and we'll look at them. And finally, we'll identify and explain the instruments of supply chain finance or the models. There are about four models, right? We have what we call the reverse factoring. And then we have dynamic discounting and others. There are other two more which make it four. So look at them. Okay. So now when we look at supply chain from a broader perspective, then the supply chain is all about the movement or the flow and the transportation, the flow and the transformation or conversion of goods and services, right from the procurement stage or the raw material stage. In fact, most of the goods can be raw material. It can also be semi-finished goods or work in progress. So whichever it is, right from that stage until it gets to the final consumer. So the supply chain constitutes the flow and transformation of goods and services from the raw material stage to the final consumer. And normally we say that that is a logistics. We say that logistics and supply chain activities. You see, so this flow and conversion comprises so many activities. For example, transportation. Goods must be shipped from one location to another or from the factory to the consumer in the form of distribution. So transportation activities are also part of supply chain, because without transportation activities, there can be no distribution of the goods and services. You see, so we have purchasing and supply. So when we say supply chain, in fact, some have limited it to purchasing and supply. And that has made the supply chain management, view from a lower perspective. When we say supply chain management, that it encapsulates all these activities. So it does not limit to only purchasing and supply, right? But we normally have the customer or the buyer, who is the purchaser. That is why we say purchasing. And then we also have the supplier, you see. So that relates to the supply. Because you, the customer, you need this good, or you need this service, or you need this product. And there is the supplier who is supplying you. But it is not just like when you need the product, then instantly it is given or it is provided. No, it goes through a whole lot of activities and processes, because if the product that you need, for example, must be manufactured from the raw material stage, you see, then now that the manufacturer will also rely on its suppliers to procure the raw material, and the raw material will now be converted into what? The product that you require. So it goes through a whole lot of stages. So it's not limited to just purchasing and supply. We have warehousing, and inventory management is one of the key factors that underlines supply chain management, because it's about procuring goods for resale or procuring goods for manufacturing. Is it so? All that you are procuring, which is normally done on a regular basis, is the inventory, which is constitutes cost. Most of the time, that cost will be tied up in the supply chain if one party fails to honor its obligation by paying the supplier who has supplied you the inventory. Then the supplier will also be in a fix of raising the needed capital, you see, to get more inventory. So that is this inventory management aspect is an aspect that we must take it seriously in the management of the supply chain. And we have some inventory management models that we use, right? You remember the economic order quantity, which actually specifies the quantity that must be ordered whenever you are placing order for inventory. So that is a UQ, which is normally given as, or 2 multiplied by the annual demand. So 2 annual demand multiplied by the ordering costs all over the holding costs, right? And they all be in the square root, right? Then we also have distribution. See, I indicated distribution in the transportation function. So we have what you call networks. How do you distribute your goods in such a way that you incur the minimum possible cost? You see, so we have network that is made up of your customers, your suppliers, and so on. So we can have this a network model. We have what we call the minimum life, the minimum distribution network model. You see, and then we have information flow. Information underpins all the components in the supply chain. All the elements that we can describe in the supply chain, they all need information. So your suppliers need information, because you the customer or the buyer, you will send information in the form of requests for the product to your supplier, you see, and the supplier will also send you feedback concerning the availability of the product. If the product is available, it is shipped to you, the customer, and then the invoice is also attached. Remember that here we are talking about credit sale and credit purchases. That is why we have the accounts receivable and the accounts payable in our financial statements. Okay, so here we are not selling or buying on cash, because that does not actually make the business progress, in the sense that if you are selling on cash basis only, maybe that's a policy of the organization, then your competitors will be selling on credit basis. So you can imagine what will happen to you, right? So your stock will remain, because if you are buying anything on credit, is cheaper than paying cash, although on credit terms you may be paying interest. But that is cheaper, and that is what happens across the world. In fact, most large organizations, they buy and they sell on credit. But you see, when you talk about small organizations, like those smaller organizations that we see in our environment, and these petty traders and micro SMEs and so on, in fact, they cannot involve in this credit purchases and credit selling, right? This is normally associated with very large organizations. Okay, so when we talk about the supply chain, then we're talking about the interrelated activities that involves the flow and transformation of the goods and services from the raw material stage to the final consumer. So the activities involved in the supply chain, they are interrelated, right? And on a broader scale, we can group that of a manufacturing firm into three. The manufacturing firm will have its suppliers upstream. Now, suppliers upstream is what we normally associate with inbound logistics. So you see that we have logistics. All the logistics that takes place at the procurement stage. So we refer to them as inbound. So when you are purchasing your inputs, your raw materials that will be converted into the finished product. I gave an example of Vaco. See, Vaco produces these aluminium ingots from raw bauxite, right? And then other companies, such as aluminium companies, they produce these saucepans, aluminium products, cooking utensils, and the roofing sheets. You see, they also rely on these aluminium ingots to produce the final product for the consumer. So when you are procuring from your supplier to get the inventory into stock, then we say that is your supplier's upstream. So that is the inbound logistics. Then you, the organization, you are the focal organization. So the manufacturing processes that will take place in your organization is the other component of the supply chain. So you are to convert the raw materials into finished products. But maybe your organization is said that it converts into semi-finished product and not the final, such as we have it in Vaco. So Vaco converts the bauxite into semi-finished, right? Then when you are converting to the consumer's consumption, that will be the final product. And that is, you have your customers downstream, or what we call the outbound logistics. You see, so the logistics is broad, as we can see there. It comprises the inbound, the manufacturing processes, and then the outbound logistics. Okay, so on a broad three broad divisions can be made, as we have seen it on the screen. Now let's look at supply chain management. Now, managing the supply chain is not the same for every organization, right? Because we can have the hospital supply chain, which is different from the conventional discrete parts manufacturing goods supply chain, which will also be different from supply chain in the financial sector. So supply chain varies from industry to industry. So managing the supply chain will vary. But when we say supply chain management, then we're looking at the coordination of activities, the flow of information among supply chain partners in order to achieve the aim of every organization. So we are managing it in relation to what we call integration. Because these days, the shift has removed. We have shifted the focus from, let's say, logistic, transportation, purchasing. Because those ones, we know that once there is a supply chain, at all costs, there will be a transportation. At all costs, there will be logistics, you see. But now we have shifted the focus to what we call integration, bringing together all the parties involved in the supply chain, because every organization does not exist on its own. Every organization depends on one or the other in order to achieve its goal. So issues relating to integration, right? Sustainability, how do we even sustain the supply chain? Because supply chain is also surrounded by several uncertainties, which is risk. So you need to even manage the risk that are surrounded in the supply chain environment, right? The risk that are associated with your buyer, because you are giving the goods to your buyer on credit. And that is risk, risk that you are taking, whether your buyer will even honor its obligation within the terms of the agreement or in the period of agreement, right? And then our aim is to what? Optimize working capital. So the supplier, you see, when the supplier delivers the goods to the buyer, the buyer must what? Pay at the stipulated duration. So if the buyer refuses to pay or is unable to pay, then you can see that the supplier will not have the working capital to continue the business. You see, and that will break up in the supply chain. And we cannot attain to what we call sustainability. We cannot sustain it. So when we talk about management, then the shift is focusing to these aspects. Well-established concept within large organizations. In the beginning of this lecture, I made mention that larger organizations have well-established system of supply chain, so they can manage supply chain more appropriately than smaller organizations. And again, it has become a competitive advantage in terms of cost minimization, you see, and improvement in customer service. So in a brief, that is supply chain management. Now, our focus is on supply chain finance. So I don't want to go into more details about the supply chain and supply chain management. But for you to understand supply chain finance, you also need to understand supply chain management and even the supply chain itself from a broader perspective. Now, let's look at the aims of supply chain finance. Supply chain finance, what brought supply chain finance? And I indicated earlier on that it's as a result of the 2008 financial crisis. Now, firms were lacking finance from banks. So firms and their supply chain partners have been facing constraints. You see, cash flows has been constrained and that has been squeezed. And it having negative impact on the capital, that is the working capital of suppliers. You see, so since the financial crisis in 2008, firms and their supply chain partners have been facing constrained cash flows and have found it difficult to get finance from banks. We all know the nature of the 2008, what we call the credit crunch, which had actually originated from the US subprime mortgage and translated into the real world economy and affected almost every organization. So some measures actually facilitated the development of this supply chain finance, right? We'll come to that, okay. But what is supply chain finance? It aims to optimize the financial flows at an inter-organizational level. As I indicated earlier on, supply chain finance involves different organizations. So at the organizational level, through solutions implemented by financial institutions or technology providers, you see, it is the financial institution that normally acts as the host. So there will be the buyer who could be an organization. There is, and most of the time it's an organization, right? there could be a supplier who is also an organization, and then the financial institutions who is acting as the host. So these three partners join to implement supply chain framework. And there should be a technology provider, so such as the internet or the web-based form of communication. Because, for example, the invoice that will be issued by the supplier will be an electronic invoice, and that will be placed on the platform, you see, before the financing aspect can take place by the financial institution. Now, it also aligns financial flow. It is so by optimizing the financial flows among organizations, it aims to align financial flows with product and information flows. Product, you see, in supply chain, when we say the supply chain is more effective, it does not only focuses on the flow of products, but then information must also flow. For example, if the supplier and the buyer, they don't have any good relationship, you see, then there will be no information flow, and that will stifle the progress of the supply chain. So information flow, in order to improve cash flow management from a supply chain perspective, you see. So the supply chain finance is actually about improving cash flow management, right? We'll say that the supply chain finance is the use of financial instruments, practices, and technologies for obtaining or optimizing the management of the working capital and liquidity, which has been tied up in supply chain processes for collaborating business partnership, right? That is, when you talk about buyers, you talk about suppliers, and then the financing institution, which is actually a bank. Okay. Now, it is also to reduce the overall capital cost. See, when you are seeking for capital, or you want to get capital from a financial institution, there is cost attached, and that's actually the interest. So supply chain finance actually aims to also reduce these costs and then speed up the cash flow to increase the credibility of the supply chain, right? Owing to the increased cash flow and credibility, the parties, that is buyers, who will benefit from extended payment terms. You see, normally it will take a reasonable term for the buyer to pay the supplier. So an extended payment terms by receiving loans from the financial service providers to settle payments with its suppliers. So in effect, supply chain finance aim at improving the overall credibility of the overall supply chain, including buyers, suppliers, and financial service providers through inter-organizational approach. Okay, so that is the aim and objective of supply chain finance. Now let's look at some of the processes involved in supply chain finance. In that, it actually focuses on what we call collaborative inter-organizational financing approach. As I've already indicated, you see, collaborative inter-organizational financial approach. So if your CFO hasn't gotten any collaborative factors, you see, in his organization, is unable to collaborate with other organizations, then supply chain finance cannot work. So when financial situations of different parties, including customers, suppliers, and service providers along the supply chain are optimized by integrating all the financing processes, and that is what we call supply chain finance. So when all of them come together, right, and then they are integrated into all the financing processes. So in supply chain finance, one, for example, companies will collaborate with each other to maximize their mutual benefits. And let's see how the collaboration is done. For example, companies such as those involving supply, so a supplier, right, may sell his or her product to, may sell the invoice. You see, the invoice will be issued from the supplier to the buyer. So the buyer must pay the invoice within a stipulated time. But sometimes the time span within the agreement or the contract might be too long. So the supplier will sell the invoice to banks or any other financial service provider at a discount. You realize that if you have invested, let's say you have purchased a fixed deposit account, you have invested your money in a fixed deposit, let's say for 1 month or 3 months, but then something has happened and you need your money, then you can be paid at a discount. They will deduct some percentage from the money because it has not actually gotten to the maturity stage. You see, so companies such as those involving suppliers may sell their invoices to banks or any other financial provider for a discount in order to cash in the invoice, you see, immediately for achieving better cash flow. So in that case, then the supplier will be liquid enough in order to conduct its normal business. Otherwise, the goods that has been released to the buyer will be locked. It's locked because the buyer has not paid. So the goods has been locked in capital, you see, and that has also locked the seller's capital. Okay, but when the bank pays through a discount, then the supplier will be liquid enough to transact its normal business or its normal operations. So service providers such as banks are often referred to as the risk takers. Of course, because the bank is paying the supplier earlier, right? So because the bank must wait for the buyer to pay when the time comes or when the date is due, the buyer must pay the bank the full amount of the goods that it has received from the supplier. All right. Now, the role of bank financial service providers is the most critical because they control the discount rates of it while bearing all the risk. Okay, so the banks actually, they control the discount rate. So they have a very key role to play. Now, let's look at the factors that influence the development of supply chain finance. First, we'll look at the global financial crisis of 2008. Okay? The global financial crisis of 2008. Now, this crisis had its root in the US subprime mortgage crisis of 2007. Okay, and put the bargaining powers of businesses at a disadvantage with the banks. Now, when trying to acquire funds, so businesses were unable to raise capital from the banks because of this what we call the credit crunch. Now, the global financial landscape changed totally with the failure of several large financial institutions and subsequent government intervention to prevent imminent collapse. So the government actually intervened, right? And that led to the intervention favored this supply chain finance. Okay. So the lack of trust and uncertainty, in fact, there were a lot of mistrust and uncertainties, led to disruptions. There were a lot of disruptions in the short-term funding. So when you want short-term loans in the short-term funding markets, and bank credit stocks, you cannot obtain that loan because there were a lot of disruptions and uncertainty. Okay, so some of these shocks were transmitted from the financial sector to the real economy. So the shocks were transmitted from the financial sector to the real economy, and these were done via the existing transaction channels. And furthermore, squeezing the available funds, you see. So in effect, participants in the supply chain actually were forced to find new ways of financing their businesses. And that led to the emergence of the supply chain finance. Now, the second one is about the changing level and position of inventory maintained by businesses. You know that inventories exist throughout the supply chain. What I mean is that right from the procurement stage to the final consumer, inventory exists in several forms. So inventories exist throughout the supply chain and flow at raw materials, as raw materials. They can come in as raw materials, as components, as semi-finished goods, as products, I mean, and so on and so forth. Okay. Or they come as a final or finished product ready for delivery to the customers. So these inventories, however, are a source of cost for the company because the company has spent money in buying these inventories, either for conversion into finished products or for resale. So as they tied up a substantial part of its working capital, you see. So when you look at the working capital, substantial portion of it is tied up in inventory. Okay. So making it less responsible or responsive to the volatility of market demand. So organizations now want the inventory to be held in the early stages of the supplier. And that was also one of the factors. Now, when you look at globalization, then globalization actually characterizes every aspect of the economy. So there are several issues that characterize financial transactions.